Welcome to the class on game theory in the autumn term 2020 at the University of Mannheim. First, I will talk about formalities. So this class will have five parts. First, there is a manuscript of 130 pages, which is in fact quite dense. It is available on Ilias. And it will be explained in a large number of short videos, which will be available on Ilias and also on YouTube Mathe Mannheim. Second, this manuscript is accompanied by 11 exercise sheets, which give a lot of examples which illustrate the theory in the manuscript. And on the other side, the theory of the manuscript is made for such examples. So each Tuesday, starting from September 29, there will be one exercise sheet published, and you will have up to 1 week to submit your solutions. So 1 week later on Tuesday until noon o'clock, you should submit your solutions via Ilias. Each exercise sheet is worth 16 points, and in order to be allowed to the written exam at the end of the course, you should reach at least half of the points of all exercise sheets together. That means 11 times 8, 88 points. Third, there will be 11 exercise sessions on Tuesday at 1:45 to 3:15, starting in the second week. That means on October 6th. It will take place via Zoom, and Khadija Larabi will explain our solutions to the exercises. Fourth, we offer an additional exercise session in a meeting hall in B6 on Thursday from 1:45 to 3:15. This starts already on October 1, I think. It will be held by Matija Vujic. This is really optional. Those of you who happen to be on the campus can go there, and you can ask questions about the lectures and about the exercises and have discussions with Matija Vujic, and he might explain some additional material. So fifth, at the end of the course, there will be a written exam, and the date for the first exam is already fixed. It is January 12, 2021. For those of you who are ill there or cannot come or don't succeed, there will be a second exam later before the spring term starts. So this is something about the formalities. More details can be found on the homepage of the class. So there is a homepage, but there is also an Ilias account of the class, and you should look at both of them. On the Ilias account, there will be available the manuscript and the exercise sheets, and you have to submit your solutions. And also the feedback for you will appear on the Ilias account. So you should log in there at some time. So now I start with the lectures, but first I say again something general. So game theory is a rather young theory, essentially mathematical theory, but it's most important nowadays in economics. It was founded by a book of an economist, Morgenstern, and a mathematician, von Neumann, 1944. And then it has developed since then in several periods. So there were good times for game theory and bad times for game theory. And I say something more about this in the introduction, which I will not repeat now. Only now I say that game theory has the larger part is about non-cooperative game theory, and the smaller part is about cooperative game theory. And the non-cooperative part is also called strategical games. And I start in chapter 2 with the most standard games, the so-called games in normal form. So this is part of non-cooperative game theory. Then in chapter 3 I will specialize to games in normal form, which are in some sense finite, and to their mixed extensions. These are most important in many applications. The short chapter 4 will be some chapter about some foundational questions. It will contain problems and concepts and quite important examples, but no theorems. I hope you will like it. Chapter 5 is again about non-competitive game theory, but now the time plays a role. Here we consider games which take place in several periods, finitely or infinitely periods. These are called extensive games. And the last chapter, chapter 6, will treat cooperative game theory. There will be a rather basic elementary solution of cooperative games, but there again is an interesting theory and again interesting combinatorics. So now I start with chapter 2 and I go right into mathematics, into precise definitions and then also results. But first, section 2.1 is mainly about definitions. And section 2.2 is about examples, which then illustrate these definitions and for which these definitions are made. So I start with a game in normal form. What is it? That is a triple A, S, U, where I write script A. So M is a natural number and script A is a set of numbers 1, 2, 3 until M. So it is a finite set of natural numbers. And these numbers stand for the players. So we have M players, and I used the word A for actor. So second, we have a set S, which is the product of sets S1 to Sn, and each of these sets Si is not empty, and Si is a set of strategies of the player I. So the upper index I is not an exponent here, it is an index for the saying that these are the strategies of the player I. And this set should be not empty, but it can be finite or infinite. And the elements of Si are called strategies, and the elements of S are called strategy combinations. So there are m tuples of strategies, for each player one strategy. And the letter big S stands, of course, for strategy. So U is a tuple of scalar valued maps from S to R. So U goes from S to R up to M. It is a tuple of maps UI, and UI goes from S to R, and UI is the utility function of the player I. So for each strategy combination small s and big S, UI of small s is a real number, and that is the utility for the player I of the strategy combination small s. So this makes a lot of sense. And U, big U, of course, stands for utility. And this is all. This is a setting in which we work for the next few weeks in the chapters 2 and 3. Nothing more. We just have this setting. This triple of a set of finite set of players, a product of strategies, of sets of strategies, and utility functions, or this utility map U. And also our idea about the players is rather bounded and precise. We suppose that all players know the game. All players know what is the set of players, what is the set of strategic combinations, and what are the utility functions. And they also know that all other players know this triple. So everything is known. Here's nothing hidden in the moment. Later in chapter 5, we will also consider games where some information is hidden and not known to all players, but not here. So time here plays no role. All players choose simultaneously at one point their strategies without knowing the choice of the other players. So the game takes place only once. At the same moment, all players make a choice of one strategy. And afterwards, one sees what is the outcome, what is the strategy combination, and what are the utility values for the single players. And of course, any player wants to maximize his utility, and they are rather emotionless. They are not altruists. They are also not mean. They are egoists, and they are as rational as possible. In chapter 4, I will discuss the validity of these assumptions. In the real world, they are not all this good, but it's good to have them for a nice theory. So nowadays, of course, people are not always rational, and they might be altruists, they might be mean, they might not understand the game well. These are all real important problems, which are also part of game theory nowadays, but it's difficult to make a theory around them. So usually we make these assumptions. The people are egoists and act in a rational way. They have they are rather emotionless. They just want to maximize their own utility. So in order to go on, we need some more notions. So one could look at a slightly more general frame for games, especially the utility function induces a so-called preference order on the set of strategy combinations. So for the player I, his utility function induces his preference order on the set of strategy combinations in the following way. If you have two strategy combinations, S1 and S2, and the utility UI of S1 is bigger or equal to the utility of S2, then the player prefers S1 to S2. So then S1 is better or equally good as S2. So and this defines a so-called preference order. That means this order is reflexive. For any strategy combination, it is bigger or equal than itself. It is transitive. If S1 is better or equal to S2, S2 is better or equal to S3, then S1 is better or equal to S3. And it's connected, so for any two strategy combinations, we have that S1 is better or equal to S2, or S2 is better or equal to S1. Both at the same time is also possible. So it's not exclusive here. So these three properties make in preference order. And yeah, the precise values of the utility function are usually not so important because the player wants to maximize its utility anyway. Important are these preference orders on the state of strategy combinations. So in general, this preference order is not antisymmetric. That means if two strategy combinations satisfy at the same time that one is better or equal than the other, that does not mean that the strategy combinations are equal. They're just equally good for the player, but they do not necessarily coincide. If the preference order were antisymmetric, then there would be a so-called complete order. For example, the order bigger or equal on the real numbers is a complete order. So this preference order induces two other closely related relations, which are denoted by equally I and by bigger I. So S1 is strictly better for player I than S2. If S1 is better equal for player I than S2, and S2 is not better equal than S1 for player I. And equivalent is that the utility of S1 for player I is strictly bigger than the utility of S2 for player I. Okay, and they are equally good. Si is equally good to S2 for player I, if at the same time S1 is better equal to S2 and S2 is better equal to S1 for player I. And this holds if they have the same utility values. So, the strict preference bigger I is irreflexive and transitive. And this equal I is an equivalence relation. It is reflexive, transitive, and symmetric. So, two strategy combinations to be equally good, that gives us an equivalence relation on the set of all strategy combinations. So, and we can say still something more. So, the original preference order holds if and only if either the strict preference holds or the equally good relation holds. So better or equal is equivalent to strictly better or to equally good. And now we can say it's also something is exclusive. For any two strategy combinations, we have either that S1 is strictly better than S2, or S2 is strictly better than S1, or they are equally good. Yeah. And yeah, in fact, this preference order induces also on the quotient, on the set of equivalence classes, an order. So there on the set of equivalence classes, we then get a complete order by the preference order. So, yeah, and the motivation for this slightly more general notion of preference order is the fact that the precise values are not important for the player. The important form is the preference order on the strategy set of strategy combinations. So this leads them to a slightly bigger or slightly more general notion of a game in normal form. A game in normal form with preference order is again a triple. We have again the set of players, script A, the set of strategy combinations, script S, but now instead of the utility functions, we have a tuple of preference orders. So for each player I, we now supposed to have a preference order on the set of strategy combinations. So we will need some additional notations before we can get serious. This will be useful in a moment for the definitions which will come afterwards. So if we fix a player I, it often makes sense to consider the restricted strategy combinations where the strategies of player I are taken out. So, and this is denoted by an upper index minus I. S upper index minus I is the product of the spaces of strategies of the other players. So S1 times S2 times Si minus 1 times Si plus 1 times Sm. For example, if you have three players, then S minus 1 is the product of S2 and S3, S minus 2 is the product of S1 and S3, and S minus 3 is the product of S1 and S2. And if you have a complete strategy combination, so a tuple, an M tuple of strategies, then the restriction S upper index minus I is again the restriction where we drop the strategy Si. So all these upper indices here never mean or almost never mean exponents. They usually mean some players, that something belongs to some player. Upper index I is player I, and upper index minus I is somehow all other players. And I like to be a little bit more precise as I'm a mathematician. So we have a natural bijection from the product of S upper I and times S upper minus I to S. We just have to permute the entries, these strategies. And this permutation is a canonical bijection, and I like to denote it by this letter sigma index I. But many authors in game theory, they drop it. They just identify these two products of spaces, which is not really correct, but it's they think when it happens, when management should consider it, it is rather obvious what is bijective to what object. So they usually write utility function UI of SI as minus I and mean utility function I of S. So this is an more slim notation, it's not completely correct, but usually this doesn't hurt. But I prefer to be precise here. I will usually use this bijection sigma I. So, quite often we will look at several strategy combinations and label them by lower indices. Depending which indices we need. And then such a strategy combination is called S1J to Smj. So upper indices stand for the players and lower indexes some labeling index. And very often we will consider especially games with only two players, and then we can put the values of the utility functions into a matrix. So if we consider two players and finitely many strategy combinations, then we can put the values of the utility functions in the matrix. So in the rows, we have the strategies of the first player, and in the columns, we have the strategies of the second player. And each entry of this matrix has is a pair of two real numbers. The first number is utility of the first player of this pair of strategies, and the second number is then the utility of the second player of this pair of strategies. You will see in section 2.2, you will see a lot of examples of this. So now, next is now a definition of Maximin strategy. Now I become serious, but I will do that in the next video. So I will stop now and then go on in the next video. Thank you very much.